Okay, hello everyone, and welcome to our second Spring into STEM Taster lecture. Joining us today is Dr. Midhat Talibi from UCL Mechanical Engineering. So the lecture today is going on for about 15 minutes, and we'll have time at the end for questions and answers. So please do feel welcome to submit them via the Q&A box. And without further ado, I hand over to Dr. Talibi.
Thank you, Saleh. Hello, everyone. My name is Midhat, and I am an academic in the Department of Engineering at UCL. I work in the area of energy transitions, which means that we move away from the current hydrocarbons to the decarbonized fuel sources, such as hydrogen and ammonia. We need to understand how our current energy system are able to adapt to these exciting different fields. And that's the area I work in, and I'm very grateful that I have the support of the UKRI. So I'm a UKRI Future Leaders Fellow, and my current funding allows me to look into these the scientific obstacles that are impeding our use of such fuels with current energy systems. This lecture is about an area I'm very passionate in, and I research in engines. And because the time is very brief, I have 15 minutes, and this is a very vast topic. And I've chosen to speak about engines back then, where we are now, and what we can look to in the future. I'll try and give you, as the name suggests, I'll try and give you a taste of all of it. And of course, any questions are welcome at the end. So let's begin. And as I said, so the lecture is a bit of theory. Some concepts about engines, some of things that we do as part of our teaching course here in McInge at UCL, and some of the exciting research that we are doing in our research laboratories in the department. All right, so let's begin. So let's start with the definition of a combustion engine. An engine is basically a mechanical device which uses the chemical energy of the fuel, where the fuel and the air is burned and converted to mechanical power. And that power is translated, for example, if you're driving a car, it's translated into the rotational motion of the wheels. If it's a power plant, it's apparent as electricity. And of course, with anything that, whenever you have some kind of an energy conversion, you go from chemical energy stored in the fuel to mechanical or kinetic energy, you have losses in the form of heat, noise, and friction. And that is something that's very apparent to all of us. So engines can be classified in a number of different ways. I've listed some broad classifications here. So engines can be, one way of classifying engines is external combustion engines, like you see in the figure here below, where you're heating up a fluid, which then causes an expansion, or the more popular internal combustion engines, which exist in automotive vehicles, lorries, trains, vans, etc. The focus of this talk is more on internal combustion engines, as they're more relevant to the work that we do. Internal combustion engines can be further subdivided into two broad categories based on how the fuel inside is ignited. So they can either be divided into spark ignition engines, or commonly known as gasoline engines, or compression ignition engines, which are commonly referred to as diesel engines. Another way of classifying engines, which I'll expand more into in the upcoming slides, are reciprocating and continuous combustion engines. And as I said, I'll speak about more of them in the slides that follow. So applications-wise, engines have a wide variety of applications, particularly because they have very high power to weight ratio. So as you may know, they're used in automobiles, lorries, aircrafts, helicopters, very large ships, to generate electricity, in gas turbines. So very widely used, and a very, very popular mechanical device, which has been in development for decades. And it's reached a point now where it is a very, very efficient energy conversion mechanical system. But going back, the diesel engine was first conceptualized by Rudolf Diesel, a German inventor. The engine that he developed, which was the world's first diesel engine, weighed about 4.5 tons, very heavy. It was only able to produce power 20 horsepower with an efficiency of 26%. Although by today's standards, that's quite low. But back then, when the best or most efficient steam engine was only 12%, this was a significant jump in efficiency. And of course, with any scientific innovation, because there are a number of people working on innovations, there were some disputes about with Rudolf Diesel's innovation and patent and the work that other people were doing simultaneously. But anyways, he is considered to be the person who invented the diesel engine. So that's where we started from. Over the next few slides, I'll show you where we have come and what are the more popular applications of engines currently. So here we have a marine two-stroke ship propulsion engine. It's able to drive a ship which weighs 210 kilotons. So it's a large bulk carrier ship. It's an 8-cylinder, you can see it's huge, and has an efficiency of 53%. And it's made of specialist materials because heat transfer is a very big problem with such engines. So it's made of very specific materials which are able to dissipate that heat. Engines are also used in goods and passenger trains. So the trains that we use for our daily travel, and then they come down to smaller engines which are used in automotive passenger cars. Such as the 1.6 turbocharged diesel engine that you see here. So a wide variety of applications. Engines are also used for power generation. So this is an example of a gas turbine continuous combustion engine where you have electricity being generated and the exhaust heat from the engine is used to heat up hot water. And both the electricity and the heat generated is then sent to the grid, to the network that is targeted. And they're generally very efficient. They're able to, the engine itself is about 44% efficient. And but if you take into account, because you're utilizing the exhaust gas, the heat of the exhaust gas as well, it brings up the overall efficiency to 90%. So the combined heat and power generation, hence, is a very good concept to develop very efficient power and heat systems. Just an interest, this might be one of the most powerful diesel engines in the world. You can see it's being carried out on a massive lorry. Here, it weighs 2.3 kilotons. It can develop almost 82 megawatts of energy at a very good efficiency of 43%. Just to give an idea of scale, that's the engine being worked on for maintenance. And you can see a man just standing there. So that can gauge the size of this engine. So yeah, engines go in all sizes, from very large to this engine. This is a very popular engine around the world. It's used for power generation, for local power generation, for domestic uses, used in lawnmowers. It's used in go-karts. It's a very popular engine. We used this engine as part of our engine lab in the very first year. So our first year undergraduate mechanical engineering students, a couple of months in when they start the degree, they do the engine lab. And they use this Honda GX160, which is a very small 160 centimeter cubed engine capacity, 3.6 kilowatts power. And they're given this engine with an instruction booklet to dismantle the engine. And they take the engine apart, they look at the different components of the engine, and they understand how the different components work, how they fit in together. They understand some lab practical skills, and they put it back together, and then they run the engine. So it's a very exciting lab that we do. So I have a quick 15-second video here, which just takes you through the dismantling process, because when they dismantle, they just put the different parts, they lay it on the table, and we have made a very fast time lapse of it, and it's a very interesting. I'm just gonna play it now. So they start from the exhaust, the filters, the carburetors, carburetor engines, they leave the carburetor on, then that's the fan cover that comes on, the fuel tank comes off next, then they drain the engine of oil, and then the oil cover comes on, then you have the engine head, which is taken off, and then finally you have the camshaft, which comes off. So we dismantle the engine to quite a degree, and then we just have the chassis of the engine left. And then the engine is put back together. So quite an exciting lap. Let's move on. So a bit about reciprocating internal combustion engines and how do these work. So most reciprocating internal combustion engines work on the four-stroke cycle principle. And this is very important to understand because this is how you get reactants come into the engine where they react and then the exhaust gases are exhausted or vented out of the engine. So you start with the intake stroke where the intake valve opens and the piston moves down. It creates a partial vacuum inside and is able to pull in fresh air and fuel mixture into the combustion chamber. This then moves to the second stroke, which is the compression stroke, which where both valves close and the chamber becomes a sealed system. And then the piston moves up and compresses them to a high pressure and temperature. Then in this case, because this is a spark ignition engine, you have a spark which ignites the compressed fuel mixture, which creates the thrust. And the thrust is able to push the piston down, as you'll see now, which pushes the piston down. And the piston is connected to this connecting rod, which is able to convert the linear motion of the piston into a rotational motion. And this indirectly through a variety of other components like the gearbox is then, let's say if this is for a car, it's connected to the wheels of the car. And the thrust then is able to make the wheels of the car go around. And then finally, because we have utilized the fresh air and fuel which has been pulled in, we need to exhaust that. So the exhaust valve opens in stroke number four, and the exhaust valve then pushes, and then the piston is pushes the exhaust gases out. And all of this is then repeated. That's why this is known as the reciprocating four-stroke engine cycle, because the process just keeps repeating, just keeps going on and on. So the most important bit of the reciprocating engine cycle is introduction of the fuel. So how do you get the fuel in into the engine? And again, here I'll deal with two methods, what used to happen and what we do now. So before, sorry, this is slightly a bit text heavy, but just to convey the information, I'm not going to go through all of it. But basically, the idea is that when the piston moves under the intake stroke, it creates a partial vacuum inside, which pulls in air. So air comes in via this pre-chamber, which is known as the carburetor, where the fuel mixing happens. And this comes in via the choke valve and goes through this area reduction. And when it goes through this area reduction, the pressure drops. And this is able to pull in fuel from this reservoir here. The fuel gets pulled in and that mixes with the air. And then this then ends up into the combustion chamber, which you saw in the slide before. So the carburetor was like a pre-mixing chamber. However, the carburetor had its own issues. The carburetor was designed because it's not very flexible. It was designed for a fixed rotational speed. Now, when driving, for example, you're going from driving a car, your speed requirements change, right? You're going faster on the motorway, slower within the city centers. You have a different speed when you're going uphill or just so you need to be able to cater to variety of speeds. And that wasn't very possible with the carburetor. Carburetors had other issues of maintenance, et cetera, as well. So now we have moved on to something known as fuel injection, where we have these high pressure nozzles, which are very, very tiny holes where the fuel is pushed at high pressure. And that's known as fuel injection. And this can happen in one of two ways. It can either happen in a pre-chamber or it can happen directly into the engine cylinder. And which method is used depends on the application. But what this entails is that the injector can have can be independently controlled using the engine control unit. So depending on what the load demand is of the engine, the injector can inject a certain amount of fuel, and it does not rely on the flow of air as it did with the carburetor. So again, this allows for a better control of engine power. This allows for a better control of emissions. So injectors are mostly used in modern engines nowadays. as they're just more efficient at they just made the engines more efficient. So just a quick diagram to show, this is a tip of the injector. That's how the fuel is injected. The fuel comes as a fuel jet, and then it breaks into ligaments. And the idea is for the fuel to break into these tiny droplets so that the surface area is increased and the surrounding air is able to react with the droplets and lead to combustion. So I've just outlined the process here where it goes from a fuel jet to very tiny droplets, which then react with the air. You have a low temperature fuel breakdown and then leads to combustion. And then that produces energy, it produces CO2, water vapor, and combustion product, which are pollutants. So again, this is something that we do in our labs. You can see we were able to visually see, because engine is like a black body, but we modify our engines so we can actually see inside them. So this is the side view of the spray. You can see the spray being injected. And this is the bottom view. So you can see the spray, that's your spray being sprayed into the combustion chamber. And the way this was done was the piston was modified to have an optical window inside. So we can see the spray being injected and then combustion happening. You can see the flame propagating. And this is how we study the effect of different fuels and how the flame propagates. This is a very, very relevant study to do our work. So this is how one of our diagnostic imaging, one of our diagnostic techniques that we use here. So this leads us on to the issue, right? When you have combustion, of course you produce energy, but you also produce some unwanted emissions, important emissions, which are in the form of unburned hydrocarbons. So the fuel CO2, greenhouse gas, CO, so partially oxidized carbon. Then you have oxides of nitrogen, which again is a greenhouse gas. And you have particulates, which are small carbon deposits, which can travel in, like you can see from smoke here, which can have a very toxic impact on human health. And hence, a lot of research that is going on generally for in energy, in the area of energy, is to reduce these pollutant emissions, primarily targeting NOx and particulates. And of course, there's a lot of focus in the media as well, especially in London. Interestingly, this picture was taken outside one of our offices. This windowsill had been painted about 3 weeks ago. And because there is so much traffic on the road, this is the amount of soot and dust that has built up, and someone drew or wrote soot on this. I just took a picture of it. But you can see a London bus passing the background. So there's a lot of pollutant emissions on the road networks, which need to be dealt with. And that's kind of our motivation for the work that we do. Why are particulates particularly dangerous? Because these small particles, the very, very small particles, which get generated through combustion, they can actually go very deep. They can travel very far down the respiratory tract into the alveoli and then get deposited. And that's where they cause the most damage. They cause a lot of cardiovascular diseases, which can be fatal in some instances. So it's very, very important that we make efforts to deal with these unwanted toxic pollutant emissions. So one of the ways to deal with this is to shift to better fuels. So we go from fossil fuels, which have been using for years, to biofuels, which again have issues of, for example, if your current biofuels come from food crop, they compete with food, they damage the land. In some cases, they might be as polluting. To going to advanced biofuels. Advanced biofuels come from biomass, from waste, and they are more sustainable, carbon neutral, and they lead to lower emissions. And that's one of the aspects that we work on in our research. So that's a fuels-based approach to reduce emissions then. Of course, there's a lot of talk about hybridization, electrification of energy systems. And again, while that is a very efficient way of reducing emissions at point. For example, if your car electric, it will not be producing these pollutant emissions. What you need to think about what's happening, the energy that they've been generated to charge those batteries is being produced somewhere. So are you just shifting the problem? So while you're getting reduced pollution on road networks, which is a very good thing, but the power needs to be generated somehow. And can you cope with the increased amount of energy? Does the infrastructure exist to be able to supply enough energy if everything becomes electrified? How do you deal with the waste? And that's why the way we see things happening, we see hybridization is a medium-term solution where you have a combination of the IC engine and the electric motor working in tandem, where one compensates for the other. The other aspect I'd like to very quickly cover, this is a research that I did a few years ago. This is the hydrogen combustion research that we did at UCL. And this is a fully instrumented engine that we have in one of the labs. And this is an engine that you commonly see in one of those courier lorries. It's a four-stroke diesel engine. And we have converted this into a research engine. Where we are measuring the incident pressures, we are measuring temperatures, we are measuring exhaust pollutants. So what we did with this engine was we ran it on hydrogen. And so there are a lot of details in this graph, but I just wanted to focus you on the only diesel. So the triangle, they're a little bit faint, are the NOx emissions for different power outputs. The x-axis is the power output from the engine, the y-axis are the NOx emissions. So when you go from only diesel to hydrogen, primarily hydrogen with a very little amount of diesel, you can actually substantially reduce NOx emissions. And this tallies in with the physics because the generation of NO or oxygen nitrogen is temperature controlled. And because hydrogen is able to burn lean, which means able to burn at low temperatures, we're able to reduce the NO generation. Which was a very significant output. And because with this we are displacing hydrocarbon fuel with hydrogen, which is zero carbon, we are able to, of course, reduce particle emissions as well. So again, hydrogen, barring the issues of fulfilling the hydrogen demand, but the use of hydrogen can be a very good approach to reducing emissions in combustion engines. So the last thing I'd like to cover is something else that we are working on. So we do work on gas turbine or rocket engines as well. And so we're working with the UK rocket engine company, one of the pioneers in rocket technology, and they're developing the Sabre cycle, which is the synergistic air breathing engine, with the idea that traditionally rocket engines use liquefied oxygen. But this engine has a dual operation. It can use within the atmosphere, it can use the ambient air, and then when it goes outside the Earth's atmosphere, it it uses the onboard liquefied oxygen. So our idea in this, because reaction just wants to use this with hydrogen, we are developing the burner, the combustion chamber, which is just a small component here. That's what we're working on. So what we have done, very exciting. We have developed this rig, which is working on pure hydrogen. And that is one of the core parts of my research. My project, which is known as Everywhere as Hope, so Hydrogen Fuel Technologies for Propulsion and Power, is a UKRI fellowship. And as part of that, we're looking into pure hydrogen combustion for power generation and for propulsion applications. So this is the rig that we have here, one of the labs, which is a pure hydrogen combustor. Here you can see a pure hydrogen flame from this combustor. And again, this is a fully instrumented lab, a fully instrumented burner, which allows us optical access. So if I go back, see, this is a fully covered combustion engine where we can't see what's happening inside. But because we need to run a lot of fancy diagnostics, we need to have optical access. So you can actually see the flame, you can run diagnostics on the flame. And so this is the rig that we have built to work with this. And you can see one of the other rigs, this is not pure hydrogen, this one here, but it's a combination of methane hydrogen. You can see this, the actual flame. So yeah, This was a brief introduction into engines and the engine research that we do here at UCL. I think I've exceeded my time a little bit, but I welcome any questions that you might have now. There's a question from Mickey. Doctor, I think there's a ring of engineering. So the question is, I would like to ask whether it is true that larger engines generally have better BSFC and why this is not the case. Oh, this is or not the case. Generally, so I'll take you back to the applications that I was showing earlier, which will, I think the answer is just in the presentation here. So you can see, right, the BSFC or the base specific fuel consumption of a marine engine, which is a very slow moving engine that's going to 83 revolutions per minute, as compared to a larger engine, which is going, a much smaller passenger car engine, which is going at 4,000 RPM. So the idea is that slow moving engines, because there's more time for the fuel to react with, they're able to utilize the fuel better. So hence their consumption per cycle improves. I hope that helps answer your question. I'll go back to the last one.
Thank you. Does anyone have any other questions? If you have anything, please submit now.
So what is the difference? Alan asked, what's the difference between hydrogen combustion and hydrogen fuel cells? So there are two different technologies. So hydrogen combustion is literally burning hydrogen, like we're doing here, to produce energy, and this is what we're using here. Hydrogen fuel cell is a different technology where you react the hydrogen with oxygen to produce energy and water. So you don't actually burn it, or you react with it and you produce flames like we do here. Which one's more efficient? It generally depends on the design of the combustor or the design of the fuel cell. The technology right now, the way it is, some fuel cells are more efficient because of the nature of the design, but the issues with fuel cells primarily is that they get contaminated very easily. So they need very pure, pure hydrogen, which is not the case when you're just burning hydrogen like we're doing here. So different applications call for different types of energy generation devices. For example, if you're using something in the construction industry, you can't use fuel cells because there's a lot of dirt and dust going around, and that will definitely contaminate the fuel cell. There you need an engine which is burning something which is not as polluting, which is a very hydrogen concept. I would like you to see your opinion towards engine in the future. Which do you think would be the most popular one recently used for cars, petrol engine or hybrid one? There are a few needs to be advanced in the fuel efficiency. That's an interesting question. So I think I mentioned it during the talk. I think there is a lot of different approaches right now. And I don't think there is no one clear winner. As I said, every fuel system has their own advantage, disadvantage. Whether we talk about batteries, or we talk about pure hydrogen, or biofuel, engines that run on biofuels. So I think some kind of a hybrid mechanism would be the way to go. We're using the best of both worlds, where you have some electrification and a combustion engine. Now, where you have the combustion engine, what fuel is driving that combustion engine becomes very important then. And that is part of the work that we do, that can we move away from the very polluting hydrocarbons towards something like hydrogen, or something like the carbon neutral biofuels. The second question that Sim was asked, is there still a lot of space for fuel engines to be advantage on the fuel efficiency? The current concepts, no. There are small changes. Development right now is to improve the fuel air mixing. So they change the way the fuel is induced into the engine, the way the fuel air mixes, and that produces marginal change in engines. There is some research going on developing new engine concepts, and they look promising. They aren't in commercial development yet, but that can have a significant jump in efficiency. But the current engine, the way in the shape it is, you can have a marginal increase in efficiency if you you know, change the engine design slightly.
It looks like that might be all for now.
Okay, thank you.
So just wanted to say thanks a lot for joining us today, everyone. If you'd like to find out more about our future Spring into STEM talks, please check out our events webpage. Just search UCL Mechanical Engineering events. You'll find lots more there. And from all of us here, thank you for coming, and see you later.
Thank you, Celia. Thank you, everyone.